and where you were equipped to give it, the same way you would offer help to someone who's blind. So there's absolutely no reason why we have to operate on a different premise, firstly. But secondly, to your point about people who have intellectual disabilities and stuff like that, I would say that in those circumstances also, yes, it may be the case that, you know, their disability has certain unique traits in order to deal with which one has to have a certain amount of, tactical ability. But in most circumstances, an interaction would flow the way it flows with everyone else. And when it does flow that way, I see no difficulty in asking that person how you can be of help, or if at all you should try to help when they are in a difficult situation. So that's how I would deal with it, which is by trying to engage with them and ask them what they are most comfortable with. So one point that I wanted to elaborate on a little bit is something that someone mentioned a while back, which is the issue of patronizing behavior. Now this sort of patronizing behavior towards a person with a disability manifests itself in a variety of ways. For instance, it may be the case that you are giving help to someone who doesn't need it. So, we spoke about how in academic endeavors you may think that a lower academic accomplishment by someone who's disabled deserves much greater praise than it does for someone who's able-bodied. You may celebritize, this is the term celebritize I'm using consciously, this is the idea of sort of deeming worthy of celebration, small little things that someone with a disability is able to do, such as getting admitted in a school or college. So in all these endeavors, I think that, this kind of patronizing behavior can manifest itself. Now, the one point that I wanted to make is that, it may be the case that someone with a disability does not operate in the world the way you do, but they certainly bring to the table, a diverse perspective, a certain form of life experience which you don't have. The fact of having lived in a world which is not designed for them. And that, I think, is a valuable addition that a person with a disability can make to the conversation, can bring to the table. Now, I would like to ask you what, according to you, is it that someone with a disability can add? What is it that their disability sort of empowers them to having to live a life with a disability? Does that at all empower them to bring something new to the conversation or not? I would like to ask you what you think about that. Yes? Anyone?
This is Megha over here. Sorry to take you back. I just wanted to talk on the point of academics. One question that I wanted to ask is, as a professor, what exactly do you think the approach should be to dealing with students who are disabled? Because there are two schools of thought, again, which I've come across. The first is, so in many institutions, you will have this thing available that you'll give maybe extensions to students who have disabilities. You'll give them extra time in exams. You'll give them other supports which you're not giving to other students. And the second is, I've had teachers come and tell me that no, this is not required. My student is doing perfectly fine the way they are. And in fact, I believe that by giving them all of these special things, you're just marking them out as different and perhaps stigmatizing them. So I just wanted to know what is your opinion in this.
Sure. So there are two parts to my answer. One is to your specific question, and one is to a certain other set of pointers that I have noted down, which I will share with you on how professors can better integrate students with disabilities, specifically those with visual impairments, but also with other disabilities. Now, let me get to the first part of my answer first. Now, the belief that someone is doing just fine cannot be the basis to deny them the reasonable accommodations that they need in case they are genuinely needed and in case their disability empowers them to take them. What do I mean by that? Now, for instance, if you talk about the issue of extra time, right? So I had a friend back home in Nagpur you know, who would always give his exam. Before that, let me tell you that under the Government of India guidelines, it is mandated as a matter of law, not as a matter of the goodness of someone's heart, that you have to be given 20 minutes per hour extra time for giving your exams if you have more than 40% of a disability. All right? Now, therefore, if it's a 3-hour exam, that translates into 1 hour extra time. Now, you know, this friend of mine was used to take only half an hour extra, and they would snatch away his paper after half an hour because they were not aware of this rule. And he was doing all right. I mean, he was scoring 77-78% marks when the university toppers were scoring 81-82, and he did not know about this rule. Now, that professor who was, I mean, you know, if someone were asked if it was necessary for him to be given 60 minutes extra time as opposed to 30 minutes, they would have made the same argument which, you know, the second school of thought makes, which is that they are doing just fine. But if their aim is to be first in class, and if they are legally entitled to receive 60 minutes per hour for a 3-hour exam extra time, then why should they not be given that? You know, so to some extent, it also flows from sort of an internalization of lowered expectations, that if you are a disabled person, even if you're scoring 75% marks, whereas someone else is scoring 95% marks, then that's fine. At least you are getting by. So why do you need more? And one other sort of, you know, deeper philosophical point that I would like to make here is that making reasonable accommodations for someone who is disabled does involve effort, just as upholding the rights of a criminal in a society which is committed to the rule of law and, you know, wants to ensure that the guilty get punished, just as that is irksome and involves effort, the same way making reasonable accommodation for someone who is disabled does involve effort. But then if you are committed to the value of equality and diversity, that is effort that one must be willing to take, in my respectful submission. Now, to the second point, you know, as to what specific accommodations can be made for students with disabilities in the classroom, allow me a minute while I consult my notes on this. So there are 5 points that I have jotted down, you know, which, like I was saying earlier, which might be of use. Now, the first is that whenever visual content is being displayed in class, it is imperative that textual description be given for that in a seamless fashion. So, you know, this is most critical in class in subjects like economics, where, you know, the teacher might just show a graph on a board or a projector, and the disabled student will just be required to, you know, would be left to fend for themselves. Like after class, if someone is willing to give them help, then it's fine, otherwise not. So the way to address that is, in my view, for a professor to keep taking periodic feedback from a disabled student to figure out if they are able to understand or not, and to textually explain the concept. And this is not very hard. Say, for instance, you were showing a downward sloping curve in order to explain the law of demand, right? Now, the idea there is that as the price of a commodity goes up, the demand for it goes down, so there's an inverse relationship. And that is all that the graph is showing. So there's an underlying idea that underpins what the graph is showing. So there's no reason why you can't explain that textually and, you know, tell the disabled student what the graph additionally adds to that, as opposed to starting it from the graph and, you know, then taking it forward. First, explain it textually in a form that they can understand, and then get to the graph, which also you can describe in textual form in the class itself. Now, the second part of it is, you know, ensuring, and I have prepared a note containing all these suggestions, which will be circulated to all of you here after my conversation is over, which sets forth all these suggestions with supporting, you know, legal rules in terms of where these suggestions are coming from. Now, the second idea is of alternate text-based questions in exams. So now there are two parts to this, you know. One is if you have a visual question, ideally you should make sure that you are able to provide a text-based alternative for it, in the sense that the same question should be articulated in textual form without losing its essence. If that is not feasible, in the event because that should be the first way of dealing with it. Only then should you ask a different question, like a different text-based question which such a student can answer. So that's on, so far as examinations are concerned. Now, for people who have a hearing impairment, one suggestion that I think works well from what I have heard from my friends who have that is, you know, if they are familiar with lip reading, then speaking at a pace that they can understand is very important. So you can't, you know, you can't rush your words in a way that they are not able to follow. So you, if you are aware of the fact that there is a student with a disability with a hearing impairment in your class, then I would submit that, you know, the best way to deal with that is to, because this is a huge issue, that professors either speak too slowly or they speak too fast, or perhaps, you know, in a tone that a student who's engaging in lip reading cannot, well, tone wouldn't matter, but in a way that they cannot follow. So therefore, it's important to speak with them and understand what they are comfortable with, and then to abide by that. Now, the fourth suggestion is, which is a problem that I faced when I was in college to a great extent, is, you know, sometimes when you ask professors to provide you access to content, like say reading material or presentations, you know, because you can't sort of, for example, access a PowerPoint presentation while it is being displayed in class, right? So the best way to address that is for it to be given to you as a disabled student before class, so that you can also look at it and participate equally in class. Now, some professors have the view that this results in the violation of their intellectual property rights. But then under the Copyright Act, now you have a specific exception under Section 52(1)(zb), which says that, you know, reproduction of material in an accessible form for the benefit of the disabled is a fair dealing and not an infringement of copyright. So hence, that is not a sort of a well-founded concern. And the final point that I would make, which has two parts to it, is to be willing to provide help outside class. You know, in addition to the things, these are not mutually exclusive, what I have mentioned above, and you know, providing help outside class, but also other outside class, asking the student if they are able to follow what's happening, if they would require any special assistance, and, you know, show a certain amount of receptivity to their needs. And the second part I would say is that, like I was mentioning earlier, accessibility, you know, our commitment to accessibility matters precisely in circumstances in which it is hard to uphold. You know, for example, if a professor has to set many, many question papers and then has to make an alternate question for someone who's disabled, only then does your commitment to diversity and equality truly come into play, not in circumstances when it can easily be complied with. And there are a few other points that I wanted to make, you know, over and above these specific pointers. More generally, so I have spoken enough about how it is that the society should deal with disabled people, but then at the same time, the other side to that, I think, is also worth noting, which is that a disabled person also has the obligation to, you know, conduct themselves in a reasonable fashion, which is to say that not to use their disability as the basis to absolve themselves of the obligation to do things which others are required to do. You know, not to sort of expect that you be given additional brownie points on account of your disability. You know, to make sure that the demands that you are articulating are sort of genuine concerns that you have. And I would say that a disabled person who's well informed is the best arbiter of how reasonable they are in most circumstances. Now, what I wanted to ask you, you know, before concluding is, I mean, I just wanted to engage with you, you know, in discussing three fact situations on involving persons with disabilities and reasonable accommodation, with the hope that they will somewhere help us better, be better equipped to deal with the challenges involving the disabled. So if there is some time left, there is, I think, 10, 15 minutes, so we'll be done within that time frame. So, you know, I'll just, you are lawyers after all, students after all, so well, you would enjoy this section more than others. So what I'll do is I'll just read out a fact situation for you that I have set forth, that I have prepared. I'd like you to weigh in on how you think that can be dealt with. So, here's the first fact situation that I wanted to discuss. Now, assume there is, and you can note this down if it would help you to sort of participate more fully. Assume that there is a blind person who secures 75% marks in his board exams And also that there is a sighted person who secures the same amount of marks, 75%. Now, the blind person gets a lot of accolades for his achievements in the media, in the news, across the board, he's hailed as an achiever. Whereas for a sighted person, it is believed that this is not such a good result. 75% marks in today's day and age does not mean all that much. Now, according to you, is this a fair outcome? I would be happy to repeat any part of the question that you may not have understood, but I would request you to, you know, engage with this issue and participate fully.
I really don't think that that's a fair outcome, obviously, because...
Anshul, can we hear from you last? Because I would like, okay. I mean, I do want to hear your perspective, but before that I would like, because others might just be like...
Yeah, it will get jeopardized.
Ha, exactly. So I would love to hear what you have to say, but let's just see what others think about this before that.
Hello, sir. This is Aman here. Sir, yes. I believe that, again, we cannot like categorically decide whether 75% is good or not, because then we have to see who gets it.